من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله Ahsan, that was good, mashallah. We are lively now. That's how it should be. Now, there are people sometimes come to the class, just sleep. So, they don't realize that, but it's very difficult for a speaker to see somebody sleeping throughout in the session. And this happens continuously, for 2-3 days. So, I hope really that would not repeat, inshallah. I know we are tired, end of day. We have been, alhamdulillah, all praise belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we have been progressing in trying to derive lessons from the past nations and past prophets, as mentioned in the Holy Quran. Just a quick recollection, as we said, when we say past prophets, all the prophets except the prophet, the current prophet, that means our prophet, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. And Quran mentions many prophets, but mentions 25 by names. Quran alludes to number of prophets, but by name, it mentions 25 prophets. And we will look also at the past nations, especially more so than the Prophet, because the nations, how they reacted to the divine message and the divine messenger, right? Yesterday we began the discussion regarding Nabi Nuh. Nabi Nuh, as we said, is considered as Adam Athani, that means the second Adam. Because after the floods, what happened is almost the entire human population was destroyed except those who were with Nuh and those who went onto the ark, right? So almost like, there was a beginning of recreation among the human being. So he's considered as Adam the second. We will inshallah discuss about floods, about ark later on, perhaps tomorrow and the day after. But we closed the discussion yesterday by just comparing Nuh in Islam as compared to Christianity and Judaism. And we said that as far as the Bible is concerned, it does not refer to Nuh as a prophet, nor as a warner. That means the one who you would not. They consider, of course, Noah was a very important person in the literature, but not as Bible. But as far as Midrash is other literature for the Jews, something similar to what you got Hadith literature, they got Midrash. In the Midrash literature, you find that they mention no Bible, what Noah as a prophet, as an admonisher. Also, it mentions that his people used to laugh when he used to make the ark, something similar to what is found in Islam. So you can see the similarity which is there, right? Then we look at, now today we look at Surah Hud, which is Surah number 11, which discusses number of prophets, this surah. But it also discusses Nabi Noah. So we look at ayat number 25 to 27, if you have the Quran. Let's open the Quran and look at Surah Hud, which is Surah number 11 of the Quran, and then ayat number 25, 26 and 27. We'll look at them and then inshallah we will reflect on that, right? So we go to Surah Hud, ayat number 25, right? Allah says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ إِنِّي لَكُمْ نَذِيرٌ مُبِينٌ. Again, like as we discuss about the Ad, the Thamud and the Saleh, here also in this case, Allah says, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ. We sent Nuh to his own community. This is a very important point. Prophet also, when he started preaching, he first taught the Quraysh, right? His own tribe. People of Makkah. Of course, then he moved to Medina. But the first audience of Rasulullah was not only the first same tribe, but in fact, وَأَنْزِرْ أَشِيرَةَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ. In fact, there is an ayat of Quran which says, a prophet has been commanded, وَأَنْزِرْ أَشِيرَةَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ. In fact, warn your close members of the family. Ashira, that means family, clan. Akrabin, that means even close, those who are closer, right? So that's why you can see the first encounter prophet had was his own relatives. As we say, for example, in English, charity begins at home, right? If somebody wants to go and preach, let's start with the family, right? Let's tell them. So here, Nuh also is sent to his own people. And then he says, Inni lakum nazirun mubeen. To you I am a nazir. Nazir is, that means the one who warns. You'll find both the names. Prophet also has many names. One of the name is Bashir, another name is Nazir, right? Bashir is the one who gives Basharat, glad tidings, good news. Nazir is the warning, warn against what is going to happen if we disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we take it lightly. No, this is all warning. That if, for example, if you were to, for instance, we have a very good example that the sixth Imam, Imam Jafar Sadiq salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, when he was on his deathbed, he called his family members, all of them, his own sons, his nephews, everybody was called. And at that time, one of the hadiths which he gives, this is at the death time, he says, those of us who takes prayers lightly would not benefit from our shafaat. They would not receive our shafaat, right? So he's going, this is his last message. And how do we know if Abu Basir, who was a close companion, was out of town when Imam died in Medina? So he goes for ta'ziyat. Subhanallah, you can imagine how close he was, that when his Imam dies, he goes to the wife of Imam, Hamida Khatun, Hamida Barbariya, she goes and says that, you know, I'll come for ta'ziyat, for consolation, you know, for ta'zi. I'll come because Imam died and I was away. And what was his parting message? So this is what Hamida actually told Abu Basir. And this is how we come to know. We come to know Abu Basir. Hamida says that when the Imam was in his last breath, as he was in his bed, he called all the family members and then said, those of you who take prayers lightly, right, they would not receive our shafaat, right? So this is also a warning, you can see. So here Nabi Nuh says, Inni lakum nazirun mubeen. To you I am a nazir, a warner, but not only a warner, a clear warner. In other words, Nabi Nuh says he's not going to mince his words. He's not going to, for example, say things indirectly. He was very straightforward and clear, as you'll see, inshallah, as we progress today, that because of his being straightforward, what happened? People started just going away from his preaching. But he was Nazir Mubin. He came and very clearly. Sometimes people say, why do you, for example, tell? I remember one day I was in madrasa, and one day a child, came to the class, and she said to her teacher, I don't wear hijab. No, my parents have said not wear hijab, I don't wear hijab. Maybe the teacher did not have enough training to how to respond. So the teacher immediately said to the child that you'll go to Jahannam. The child was young, 10 years, 10, maybe 11, girl, she was baligha, but 10 years, 10, still a child, right? 10 years or 11 years. And she started crying and she went home and complained to the parents and said that, no, I will burn in Jahannam. And this is what my teacher has said. And of course, you know, when students hear something from teachers, they believe it's correct completely, right? They believe teachers more than sometimes parents. You know about it, right? You have this experience. So she was crying. So then the complaint came to me that your teacher doesn't know how to teach and doesn't know how to approach things. But there's a different thing. Yes, which was a child, the teacher should have been more tactful, should have, for example, tackled the hijab in a different way. Instead of immediately saying that you go to Jahannam, could have said, no, hijab is identity for Muslims, what are the benefits? But she immediately jumped by saying that you go to Jahannam. No? So of course, the child, young, 10 years old, was really confused. She went home and cried. But here, Prophet Nuh says, no, Inni lakum nadhirun mubeen. I am a clear warner to you. I'm not going to mince my words. I'll tell you exactly what Allah has sent me with and what you are supposed to do, what you are not supposed to do. And this is exactly what sometimes we feel bad. When people tell us, Sun Quran, Sun Quran, people feel bad. Who are you to tell us, right? Let us do whatever you want to do it. So that's not the case. You can see here, Quran says, Inni lakum nadhirun mubeen. That I am a clear warner to you, right? Then he says, Allah ta'abudu illallah. Right? You can see the fundamental message. This is very important. We should always talk to, even sometimes when you are with Christians and Jews, one of the biggest things is that, you know, this is the fundamental message throughout all the prophets. Quran has this, you know, documented number of places. Allah ta'abudu illallah. Do not worship anyone except Allah. La ilaha illallah. This is the fundamental message. This Trinity, what they believe, is a latter-day thing. It's not at all. It was not preached by Nabi Isa at all, far from it, right? So Allah ta'budu illallah. Do not worship anyone except Allah. Inni akhafu alaykum adhaba yawmin aleem. And imagine, because he is, as I told you, right, these prophets were really concerned about the community. I used the Gujarati word the other day, ke tone lok kompate lagni hati, right? They were really concerned about the community. They were really, you know. So he said, inni lakum, inni akhafu alaykum adhaba yawmin aleem. I fear for you that tormenting, you know, punishment. Because if you don't follow what I say, of course, I'm not going to burn. You are going to, but he doesn't say like that. It's not that, no, you are on your way. He says, I fear for you because I'm part of you. You're my community. I would not like you to really go through it. So, inni akhafu, I fear for you, adhaba yawmin azim, the punishment of the tormenting, right, day. Fakadal mala'u, subhanallah. Now comes mala'u. What is mala'u? Mala'u, the translation just is elite. Elite means what? Those who are rich, those who are powerful, those who are influential, those who matter. Sometimes we find that they want things their way, right? They don't want either our way or no way, my way or highway, right? They say. So, فَقَالَ الْمَلَوُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Those who disbelieved, the elites who disbelieved amongst those who know. Of course, there were people, not always rich people are bad. Of course, some rich people are, in fact, religious people and they support the cause. But those who were elite, and at the same time disbelieved, min qawmi ma naraka illa bashan mislana. You can see what is the response. The first response is that we don't find you other than bashar. What is bashar? Bashar means a mortal. That means a human being, an ordinary human being who is going to live and age and die. Right? So you are not an angel. You are not going to stay forever. We find you as a human being. And this is not only with them, even with our Prophet. Quran is telling us that they used to come to Prophet and says, what kind of Prophet you are? You go to the market and buy things. You marry, you have got children, you eat, you drink. What kind of Prophet you are? Do you see this? This is the first objection they got. So they say, ma naraka illa, we do not see you other than a human being. An ordinary human, Bashar, right? Bashar, that means a person is going to die, Bashar. Muslim like us. وَمَا نَرَاكَ تَبَكَ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ هُمْ أَرَادِرْنَا بَادِرْنَا. And what we find, that who follow you? أَرَادِرْنَا, that means people who are poor, simple-minded people, the riff-raff, we say in English, right? The riff-raff of the community are following you. If you really were important, if you really, you know, mattered, then why is it that people who are influential, people who are politicians, people who are rich, people who matter, why they don't follow you? Why do we find that only those who are poor, those who are slaves, those who are simple-minded, they flock to you? And this is exactly, you can see, even, do you see the reason why this thing can come? Even during the time of the Prophet, people who believed Rasulullah, first, who were the one? People who were poor, right? And how did Prophet continue? You know, when people who were poor, who were slaves, when they accepted Islam, how were they supported? Do you know? It was the wealth of Janabi Khadija. That Khadija, whom we are going to remember in a day or two, it was the wealth of Janabi Khadija. Rasulullah invested the wealth of Janabi Khadija in his missionary work and supported these people who were poor, who were persecuted, who were slaves, right? And that is why that was an investment. Today Islam is telling us, Quran is telling us, and Islam is asking us that when you earn and if you save, first of all, earn and just enjoy your money, right? Eat and drink and wear whatever you want. Live your the way you see your standard of living. But if you sell, then give 20% of that as a khums, we have objection. We are forgetting that it was the investment of Janabi Khadija, right? So in the same way they say that ma naraka illa basharun mislana wa ma naraka tabaka, and we do not see you following illa alladhina hum araziluna, those who are, that means those who are low and, you know, simple-minded people. Badira, and those who are just simple-minded, وَمَا نَرَى لَكُمْ عَلَيْنَا مِنْ فَضْلٍ, and we don't find any kind of fadl with you. We don't kind see any kind of merits. Do you see, Nabi Nuh, who is Nabi, who is Rasul, who is Ulul Azam Peygamber, right, according to our, but his people consider him as what? A simple person has no fadilat. Do you see how people judge sometimes? Unfortunately, we always judge people according to, I don't know, our own standards. So we find, oh, this is an ordinary person, we don't need to know, respect him, right? One day, One person came to Najaf, right, in the Hawza. He came there, and then as the Alim was giving Darsa Kharij is an open lecture whereby scholars come, and when the Alim is giving the lecture, especially Mujtahid, when they give the lecture, people argue and counter-argue. You know, for example, they say, what you are saying, give us a proof. Where is the proof in Quran? Where is the proof in Hadith? And they will argue, right? So the person came, and this Mujtahid started lecturing. This person argued again and again. There's no, this point you are making doesn't make sense because the ayat of Quran says this way, Hadith says this way. So when after the class, everybody went to him and said that, what was wrong with you? Don't you have respect for the alim? You are arguing like that? You know, you are just bringing a few ayats here and there. What right you had? So he didn't say anything. After the following week, he came again. But this time he put on a big amama and a big abba and everything, came to the class, and now again the mujtahid started his lesson, and he started also counter-arguing, saying that no, this is how it should be. And after that, people said, mashallah, you are so learned that you can have an ability to even argue with the mujtahid and bring about all the kind of evidences. So they said, why don't you come to our home and have a food? No, they started inviting him. So he decided, so many invitations, he went to the one who was most influential person in the community. He went to his house. When he went there, as the food came, he did not start eating. He said, oh my Abba, oh my Amama, start eating. Because this respect is on account of Abba and Amama, it's not account of my knowledge. Because I was the same person, when I argued the other day, you said I'm arguing. But now when I'm arguing with Amma and Abba, you said, oh no, I'm a learned person. So this Abba and Amama is being invited, not myself, right? So this is the kind of, they say that ma naraka, we do not find, we don't find any kind of fadl. You know, fazilat or excellence over you. Bal nazunnukum kadhibin, nauzubillah. And they ended by saying that we only find you a liar. So do you see exactly what Prophet Rasulullah faced? The same thing Nabi Nuh faced, right? The first one is, they said that, no, you are just simple person like us. The second one, they said, people who follow are all simple-minded and slaves in this thing. The third thing, we don't find you anything special. We don't find any kind of fazil in you, right? And finally, they say, nauzubillah, that you are a liar. This is exactly the same kind of challenges which all the prophets face. So this is what, in fact, Nabi Nuh faced. So we go to next slide. And that is, we go to next slide. Yeah, reflections on this verse. So this was a reflection of verse 11 now, very quickly. Allah sent Nuh to his people, number one, as a clear and a manifest warner to them. Number three, worship none but Allah. The fundamental message was don't worship but Allah. Not worshipping or disobedience to Allah will certainly result into painful punishment, right? If you don't worship or disobey Allah, there will be painful punishment. The elite, that means the rich, the influential, the arrogant, opposed him. They said, you are nothing but a human like ourselves. Only simple-minded and riffraff followed Nuh. That's what their claim was. Nor do you have merits over us. You don't have any kind of fazilat with the payment. And finally, they say that you are just a liar, right? We go to the next slide. Whereby Nuh not alone, but there are a number of prophets who are considered as warners in Quran. So we have the name, for example. Nuh is numbered among the prophets of warning. Prophets who are Nazir Mubin, right? Number of prophets. Amongst them was Hud, Saleh, Lut, Shu'aib. Shu'aib in English is known as Jethro, Musa, conveying threats of punishment to their sinful people, right? Clearly, they clearly conveyed the message of Allah that if you disobey, there is a punishment waiting for you. People took that as a threat, as you'll find as we today discuss about Nuh, that how he tried so much and how people in fact reacted. But he's not the only one. Number of prophets in Quran had mentioned is those who are warners, right? We go to the next slide, which is slide number 5. Nuh carried actually the nur of the prophet. See how important it was that when the tufan came, when the floods came, right? It was important that Nuh survives. You can see the hadith. There's a hadith from the prophet Hadrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which has been quoted by Agha Mehdi Mirza Puya in the tafsir by S.U. Mir Ahmad Ali. He quotes a hadith. He says, and I'm important, I'm telling you this hadith and I'm telling you the reference because I'm fasting. When a person is fasting, if you lie, if you quote a hadith which is wrong, right, then your fast breaks, right? And not in the fast breaks, and if I do it deliberately, there will be not only qaza, but there will be kafara for that, right? So I have to be careful that when I quote a hadith, I have to give the reference, or at least say, know where it is coming from. So this is Agha Mehdi Mirza Puya, was a great mufassir of the Quran. In fact, I understand that even marhum Allama Rashid Turabi used to go to him to seek advice, because he was a mufassir of the Quran. Agha Puya was a mufassir of the Quran, so when Allama Rashid Turabi would recite a majlis, sometimes if he would like to clarify a certain thing, he would go to Agha Puya to seek clarification. He quotes a hadith. He says, Prophet says, Allah selected Adam in preference to all other creatures. All the creatures, Adam was preferred, number one. From amongst the descendants of Adam, he selected Nuh. You can see, of all the descendants, right? From among the descendants of Nuh, he selected Ibrahim, right? And from among the descendants of Ibrahim, he selected Ismail, his own son, right? From among the Quraysh, he selected Hashim, right? And from all of them carried Mainu, that means Prophet says they all carried Mainu, that means the first light which came forth from the absolute and goes on till the day of resurrection to manifest ultimately in the arc of ascent, right? That special Nur. It passed through Abdul Muttalib to Abdullah to Abu Talib. I am from Abdullah and Ali is from Abu Talib. Ali and I are one in the same Nur. Do you see? So this is how that original Nur, primordial Nur, we started from Adam all the way it came to Rasulullah and Imam Ali Islam. That is the Nur which is mentioned. So it was important that Nur in fact survives the flood and carries on the Nur, right? There is a surah, we go to the next slide, number 6. There is a surah in the Quran which is known as Surah Nur, surah number 71. So we will look at that surah in detail and then also look at other verses. But just now we'll try to concentrate because there is a whole surah on Nur. And it's interesting because sometimes if you want to pursue, if you like to, for example, read on your own, then you know that not like instead of reciting the entire Quran or going to search entire Quran, at least this surah, you can look at it. So let me summarize for you the surah, what the surah says. Just a summary. The surah that says that Nuh continuously urged his people to repent their sins while both warning them of the consequences of God's punishment and conveying them to God's promise of reward if they repented. Do you see the style? This is important. As I gave you earlier the example of that girl, right? That teacher who told the girl that you will burn. That was only one part of it. Do you see when the prophets come, they give both. They give warning, but at the same time they give also good news, right? There should be hope and fear. You cannot only scare people. You're supposed to give them hope also. It is very important. Even that is what we sometimes fail. We as parents, with due respect, sometimes what we feel that we always just give negative. I remember when I was young, and the only thing I remember, if you don't say namaz, you are going to burn in Jahannam. Tantan Varda, you are going to burn in Jahannam. This is it. Nobody said that. No, when you say namaz, so much reward will be there, right? If I share with you the reward of saying namaz, that reward alone would be enough for us to say namaz. We'll forget about other things else. There is so much reward, right? So why don't we just also sometimes look at the positive aspects? Why always scare people, right? So here you can see that Nuh continuously urged the people to repent their sins while both warning them of the consequences of God's punishment and conveying them to God's promise of reward if they repented. Inshallah, I'll show you, just now we will see at the ayat regarding istighfar and the benefits of it as Nabi Nuh says. The people did not accept his warnings and instead urged him to worship their pagan gods. They asked him to worship the idols, exactly like Prophet, right? They came to Prophet and said what? That we have so many gods, 360 gods. To add one god, 361, no problem, we'll also worship Allah. But only one thing, how about you worship our god and we worship your god? 6 months you worship our god, 6 months you worship your god, right? Sometimes you worship our god. It was a suggestion. Today we'll say it's a good suggestion because it's a win-win situation, right? Today we always say let's do win-win. But there are certain things you can't have win-win. So a whole surah was revealed to this suggestion. What was that surah? Anybody knows? Al-Kafirun. Yeah. A'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajim. We can recite together. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Qul ya ayyuhal kafirun. La a'budu ma ta'budun. وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ وَلَا أَنَا عَابِدٌ مَا عَبَدْتُمْ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينِ. The whole surah is revealed, whereby it clearly says, لَا عَبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُ. I am not going to worship what you worship, nor are you going to worship what I worship, because you worship idols, I worship Allah. There is no question of compromise here. No, either you drop worshipping idols, or Nauzubillah, you want me to drop worshipping Allah. That's not possible. I'm never going to drop worshipping Allah. And since I'm going to worship Allah, there is no way that I can worship idols. Do you see this thing? But what we have done today, we worship Allah, but we worship also dollars. You also worship, for example, no beauty. We worship power, we worship influence. All those things are also there, right? We only worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is it, that la abudu ma ta'bud, wa la antum abiduna ma abud, nor are you going to worship what I'm worshiping. As long as you are idol worshippers, you can never worship Allah. Because worshipping Allah requires what? Not worshipping others. La ilaha illallah, right? It is a condition. We can only worship Allah if we don't worship others. Otherwise, that is not a proper worship, right? So here is it, that clearly, they said, no, you worship our gods. This account ends with their being drowned in the deluge, that means in the tufan, right? Being cast into the fire and Nuh asking Allah not to leave any unbelievers in the land. In fact, Nabi Nuh was so much angry and frustrated with his people, right? After all these years of what preaching, when they in fact disbelieved him, he prayed against them. Nabi Nuh prayed against his own community. Why? Because they were so arrogant. And you will see inshallah what they did to him, right? And when he prayed, he said to Allah that don't only punish them, but don't leave anyone amongst them. Which is quite strong, right? Let's see, why would the Prophet do like that? A Prophet would not supposed to do that, but why was it happen? So let's look at the next slide, number 7. If you have the Quran, let's open the Quran now and open Surah number 71. It's interesting. Again, I say, I strongly recommend you to keep the Quran in front of you. It's very important. There is a lot of reward, and I said that this Quran is going to be give witness for you that you are opening and referring to it again and again as we were trying to understand the Quran. So he says, Bismillah ar-Rahman, ayat number 5, Surah 71, right? قَالَ رَبِّ إِنِّي دَعَوْتُ قَوْمِي لَيْلًا وَنَهَارًا. Do you see? It's like, you know, there are some shops, right? Which is 7-Eleven, right? They say, or not only 7-Eleven, but not 7-24. 24 hours and 7 days, right? There is no end to it. See how he does. He says, oh my Lord, I did da'wat. I invited my people, laylan wa naharan, day and night. There was no break. Do you see this thing? It's not like 8 to 5 and 5. No. It's day and night. Whenever you got the opportunity. No. Falam yazidhum du'ai illa firara. But these people, what happened? Every time my dua, here dua that means invitation, not dua supplication. Here dua that means my invitation, my calling them, my inviting towards Islam, right? فَلَمْ يَزِّدْ دُعَائِي إِلَّا فِرَارًا. Firar that means what? And you say, هَيْدَرَ كَرَّار غَيْرَ فَرَّار, right? The same thing. That means he would not run away from the battlefront. In the same way, firar that means, as I would call them, they would run away. Nabi Nuh will stand up to just talk and they will just go away, right? So he did not increase except running away, going away from the firar. You can see the arrogance, right? Prophet of God is talking to them, they would go away. وَإِنِّي كُلَّمَا دَعَوْتُهُمْ لِتَغْفِرَ لَهُمْ. No, I actually invited them towards what? Subhanallah, you can see what? لِتَغْفِرَ لَهُمْ. That your Lord will forgive you. You know, you just believe Allah will forgive you. جَعَلُوا أَصَابِيَهُمْ فِي آذَانِهِمْ. You know what they did? They took their fingers and started putting in their ears, right? Just to close it. You can see physically, right? And sometimes they will take the abba and do like this. No, just for example, as if they don't hear. No, they'll just do like this, just to know, just to ignore that. No, we don't hear. You know, this is what they did physically. You can imagine they would just try to show to nobody knew that we are not interested. So this is what they used. Quran is telling us, you know, asarru. And they were persistent in this thing. And they were swelling with arrogance. Wastakba istikbara. No, that means they were not only arrogant, but the arrogance will go on increasing more and more. This is the attitude. Do you see? Now my question is, they physically shut off from hearing Nabi Nuh, right? How do we shut off ourselves? today in this day and age. Go outside and see how many people are standing outside, right? They will come all the way to Imam Barga. They are going to, inshallah, participate in namaz, hopefully. They'll definitely be there for iftar, I'm sure, right? But they are sitting outside. Go out. Every day I finish out, for example, go out. I see so many people there. You know, of course, we can't ask them. But you can see, this is physically, right? They would put the fingers in their ears and they would pick the abaya and just put on their head. People are there, either they were shut off their mind or they are playing with their phone, they are texting, they are playing games. One day, Maulana was giving lecture, I saw a young boy playing game actually. I was sitting next to him. I said, "What are you know why Maulana is speaking English? So that you understand. And you are playing games?" So he was, you know, at least respected. He didn't say anything, he just put the phone in his pocket. He didn't, for example, reply back. At least that was a good thing of it. But this is what's happening. We as parents, are we asking? Because today, we are giving phone to our children, right? It's become almost a must. I couldn't believe, when I came to Canada in mid-80s, one day one person who was living in Edmonton said something I could not believe. He said a time would come that everybody would have a phone in his pocket. Like I said, what is he talking? How is it possible? Now this is, I'm talking of mid-80s. Indeed today, not only everybody, every son and every daughter has a phone, right? So are you asking them better? Are you playing with this phone when majlis is taking place? Do you keep it aside? You know, do you listen to it? Do you ask this thing at least sometimes? That you're, you know, so they used to do this physically. We also do things whereby we keep away from the message, right? So, and then he says, you know, istikbara. Summa inni da'autuhum jaharan. Sometimes I even invite them loudly, right? I'll stand up and jaharan, that means with a loud voice, people can hear. For example, you've got namaz which is ikhfati and jahriya, right? The maghrib namaz, the isha namaz, and the fajr namaz are known as salat which are jahriya. Why jahriya? Because the main folk are supposed to recite surat al-fatiha and other surah with a raised voice such that if somebody is standing next to me can know exactly what I'm reciting. At least somebody was next to me. Not shout, but at least that's what jahriya. Ikhfatiya is that, no, I'll just lower my voice for what, for Surat al-Hamd and other qiraat, and also ikhfatiya in Tasbihat Arba, right? In Zohr namaz and Asr namaz, right? So he said that I would even raise my voice, jahar, right? To invite them. Thumma inni alantu lahum wasrartu lahum israra. Sometimes I would preach them publicly and privately. So he used every means, he says. Nabi Nuh is now, this is, you can imagine, Nuh talking to Allah. Nuh is complaining to Allah. And this has become part of Quran today. Why it has become so? This particular passage is people like, you know, us who preach, or people, for example, like madrasa teachers, or sometimes even your parents. Like as a parents, for example, you try to talk to your children and your grandchildren. So this passage is for us. That maybe you will talk to your children, your grandchildren, again and again, they will not listen to you. Should you give up? No. So often, parents come to me and say, "Maulana, I have given up on my son. I have given up on my daughter." I said, "No, you can't disown your son. You can't disown your daughter. She is your daughter, she is your son. She doesn't wear hijab, she doesn't listen to you, he doesn't say namaz. That doesn't mean that you cut off, you can't do that. They are your sons, you have to continue." This is, you can see Nabi Nuh saying, that I used to tell them publicly, privately, I'll, you know, say openly, I will even say loudly, they would just, you know, go away and have, you know, what, they would just be proud, right? So next slide is just a reflection of what we discussed very in the point form, slide number 8. Nabi Nuh worked tirelessly, right? Number one. Number two, his people were defiantly arrogant. They were not only arrogant, but defiantly arrogant, you can imagine. The defiance, the arrogance was full of defiance, right? And then Nuh's tabligh sent them away further. They would, in fact, they would go away from Nuh, right? Physically avoid the calling. That means they would physically avoid being called, no? Putting fingers into their ears and drawing clocks over their heads. Nowadays, how do we shut ourselves from lectures? You know, as we discussed earlier. They perished, they persisted in refusal and swelled with pride. Nuh did not give up, but called them loudly, sometimes preaching publicly and sometimes privately. So as parents, as madrasa teachers, as preachers, we cannot give up. We will continue, inshallah. One day, you know, many years ago, I went to Dubai. Even recently I was there, but many years ago, when I once first went there, I met a wakil of Ayatollah Khui Marhum, Agha Naqvi. I think still living there, Baka Naqvi is still there. May Allah give him long life. And I went there, and then I said to him that I'm in Canada doing this tabligh work. give me some advice. And he gave me very good advice. He said that you just never give up calling, right? You never give up your work. You just do tabligh. People will listen, people will not listen, people will oppose, people will write anonymous letter, everything will do. But hidayat will come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One day, no, and there is a beautiful hadith which says, a prophet says, a door which is closed, if you go on knocking, one day it will open. One day it will open. We have to try. But how, what is it? We have to try differently, right? Different kind of tactics. If your son doesn't say namaz, you can't go on nagging because he's not going to listen. Try to use other kind of ways. What are the positive external benefits of namaz? What are the reward? Try to find if he has friends or she has friends who can influence, right? Try to bring him towards the program where namaz is also there and let them participate. No, there are so many different ways we can do it, right? We can, for example, even show to them that somebody who is very rich. I know one day I was in Vancouver and somebody had died. So as somebody dies, you know, people just get together, they give ghusl, they give kafan, everything. So there was an Iranian person who had died, right? And for some reason, the family just, they said, okay, you people just take care of it. They were just sitting there, just watching everything, doing nothing. The whole family, they did not participate. The family, the friends, they were just not participating. But our committee was doing it. Now, amongst the committee of ours who was doing this ghusl kafan, there was a person who was a millionaire, who was known to be a millionaire. But he also came so humbly and helped in ghusl and kafan. So these Iranians came to me and said that we were really surprised. Because back in Iran, when a person dies, we just give it to ghusl khana and they do everything. Nobody boasts about it, right? They are, because there are funeral homes which are run by Shias, they do it. But in your case, we saw that people who are rich, and they come and voluntarily serve this thing. We were really impressed by that. And after that, because of seeing that, they started even participating in that process of funeral. Do you see this thing? So it always happens that when you find somebody doing it, so this is why I said that, no, when we, for example, invite our sons and daughters towards Salat, we use different kind of tactics. And inshallah, Allah will give us success. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us tawfiq in this holy month of Ramadan, to fast, to perform good deeds, to recite du'as, to recite the Holy Quran, to understand the Holy Quran, and to reflect on the Quran. And more so, may Allah give us tawfiq that we are able to practice what has been commanded in the Quran, the way it has been shown to us by the Prophet and his Ahlul Bayt. صلى على محمد وآل محمد